Energy flows in the ecosystem through the carbon cycle, which begins with the fixing of carbon dioxide into simple organic carbon compounds through the process of primary productivity.
Primary productivity is the initial step in the energy flow in an ecosystem, wherein primary producers like plants utilize carbon dioxide and store it in its tissue in the form of sugars like starch.
However, primary productivity is not solely based on the uptake of carbon. It is also based on the uptake of essential mineral inorganic nutrients such as nitrogen and phosphorus. So, where do these essential mineral inorganic nutrients came from?
Each element has their own story of origin and movement through the ecosystem. Initially, like carbon dioxide, these nutrients came from the atmosphere or from the weathering of rocks and minerals. Once in the soil or water, these minerals will then be absorbed by the plants and stored in its cells. As the cells of plants senesce and decompose, these nutrients return back to the soil. Unlike carbon, which is passed down by the food chain and ultimately returned to the atmosphere through cellular respiration, most nutrients in the ecosystem are recycled. Microbial decomposers play the major role in this process, in which it converts dead organic matter through the decomposer food chain pathway into a mineral form which will be once again available for use as nutrients by plants in the ecosystem. This process of recycling nutrients in an ecosystem is what we call nutrient cycling or internal cycling. Decomposition and nutrient cycling plays a major role in the recycling of essential nutrients within the ecosystem.
Essential nutrients are being recycled in the ecosystem. As for example, in terrestrial ecosystems, the essential element nitrogen follows a pathway.
Plants absorb nitrogen in its inorganic form, such as ammonium and nitrate, and then converts it into organic forms like proteins, enzymes, and various forms of nitrogen-based compounds. The availability of nitrogen and other nutrients in soil are important as it limits the rate of uptake by plants, thus affecting also the rate of net productivity and rate of photosynthesis. Thus, if the soil contains low nitrogen content, it will impede the rate of uptake by plants, which may lead to reduction in the rate of photosynthesis and net productivity. In plants, nitrogen and other nutrients are being conserved, and not all of it are being recycled 100% via decomposition and nutrient cycling.
When it's time for plants to lose their leaves in the coming cold or dry season, they resorb most of their nitrogen before doing so in the process called retranslocation.
Retranslocation or resorption is a process by which plants absorb some of the nutrients from senescing tissues into the perennial parts of the plant to be stored and used in producing new tissues. As senescence occurs, the water and nutrients are being taken away from the leaves and being transported into the stems. In this way, the plants can recover as much as 70% of the nitrogen before the leaves fall and decompose. Decomposition is defined as the breakdown of chemical bonds formed during the construction of plants and animal tissues. It is the opposite of processes like photosynthesis, in which inorganic substances like carbon dioxide and water are being fixed into organic substances like carbohydrates and proteins. Decomposition is a complex of many processes, which includes leaching, fragmentation, changes in physical and chemical structure, ingestion, and excretion of waste products. Heterotrophs are decomposers in some degree, as they break down organic matter in catabolic processes and release it partially in the form of waste products. However, typically when we talk about decomposers, we refer to organisms that feed on dead organic matter or detritus, such as microbial decomposers like bacteria, fungi, and detritivores. Organisms most commonly associated with decomposition are the microflora, which is composed of the bacteria and fungi. Bacteria are the primary decomposers of dead animal matter. They can be categorized as aerobic or anaerobic. Aerobic bacteria depends on oxygen in metabolism or respiration, whereas anaerobic bacteria thrives in regions with low oxygen concentration. Thus, they are commonly found in mud, the benthic region of aquatic habitats, and the rumen of ungulate herbivores. The type of respiration being exhibited by these organisms is called fermentation. Fungi, on the other hand, are the primary decomposers of dead plant matter. They use their hyphae in order to draw nutrients from dead plant materials. Their feeding habits also vary among species, such as that some species feed only on soluble organic compounds like glucose, whereas others invade tissues with hyphae. It should also be noted that not only one type of organism plays a role in decomposition. In several instances, after one group of bacteria or fungi exploit the material, the remaining materials can be further decomposed by a different group of bacteria or fungi. The exploitation depends to the extent of ability of the decomposer. Successions of microflora are involved in decomposing organic matter until it will be finally reduced into organic matter.
Aside from bacteria and fungi, invertebrate detritivores also play a major role decomposition through the fragmentation of leaves, twigs, and other dead organic matter.
These invertebrate detritivores fall in four major groups: the microfauna and microflora, mesofauna, macrofauna, and megafauna. Microfauna and microflora are less than 100 micrometers, which includes protozoans and nematodes inhabiting the water and soil pores. Mesofauna are between 100 micrometers and 2 millimeters. This includes mites, potworms, and springtails that live in soil air spaces. Macrofauna and megafauna are the largest, represented by millipedes, earthworms, and snails in terrestrial habitats. Annelid worms, small crustaceans like amphipods and isopods, mollusks, and crabs in aquatic habitats. There are two methods used in studying decomposition. These are litter bags and leaf packs, which involves following the fate of dead organic matter. Litter bags is the method used in studying and quantifying the decomposition rate in terrestrial ecosystems, whereas leaf packs is the method used in studying and quantifying the decomposition rate in aquatic ecosystems like streams. Unlike litter bags, leaf pack studies can quantify the diversity of micro and macro decomposers during decomposition.
Decomposition, however, occurs at different rates.
So why does matter for the forestry? Even for forest only, but for the leaf.
The answer lies in two factors, locality of the plant litter and the physical environment. Generally, rays of decomposition are faster in warm, wet environments. This is because low temperatures and dry environmental conditions typically reduce microbial activity, and in some cases, completely inhibit them. Rays of decomposition, however, do not rely only on the physical environment, but also on the quality of the carbon compounds found in the plant litter. In these cases, the rate of decomposition heavily relies on the net energy gained by microbes in breaking down such compounds. This is inversely related to the complexity of the chemical structures exhibited by the carbon compounds present in the plant litter. Simpler molecules require less energy to break down, and specifically for glucose and simple sugars, have a high energy yield that decreases net energy gain. Net energy gain thus generally decreases from simple compounds to complex compounds. For this reason, plant litters with high proportions of simple sugar and low proportions of the more complex carbon compounds, the polysaccharide cellulose, and even the more complex phenolic polymer lignin, decompose at much faster rates than those containing higher proportions of the more complex carbon compounds.
Furthermore, the decline in percent carbon remaining in the plant litter is also accompanied by changes in the levels of remaining nitrogen. This is influenced by the net mineralization rate, which is affected by two processes, namely mineralization and immobilization.
Mineralization is the process of converting organic compounds from plant litter into inorganic forms deposited into the soil, whereas immobilization is the uptake and assimilation of nitrogen from the soil, thus reducing the net mineralization rate. Unlike percent carbon remaining that constantly exhibits a decline, the pattern in change in percent nitrogen remaining in the plant litter exhibits three distinct phases. During the initial phase, leaching occurs, the parts wherein some nitrogen are leached out of the plant litter and into the soil. This causes a decline in percent nitrogen. The next phase is where immobilization exceeds mineralization. A high immobilization means that the microbes in the plant litter sequester more nitrogen from the soil and into the litter bed. This causes an increase in percent nitrogen, even exceeding 100% initial nitrogen content of the plant litter. And finally, the final phase involves mineralization exceeding immobilization. High mineralization means that the nitrogen of the plant litter are converted into inorganic nitrogen deposited into the soil. This phase continues until nitrogen content is depleted. As the process of decomposition proceeds and less and less percent carbon nitrogen remains, organic matter is altered in chemical composition. The litter eventually becomes a dark brown organic matter called humus. During the process of becoming humus, there's a prolonged period of immobilization that causes an increased percent nitrogen, which, in turn, causes a decrease in carbon to nitrogen ratio. The rate of mass loss continues and eventually slows down due to preferential consumption of simple sugars over lignin, which, as said earlier, is a very low quality carbon compound. The carbon to nitrogen ratio continues to decline due to respiration, losing carbon dioxide into the air. Organic matter from dead microbial organisms accumulate and infuses with the litter as a part of the residual organic matter. Mineralized nitrogen becomes incorporated into humus, combining with mineral particles in the soil to form colloids and incorporated into the chemical structures that are recalcitrant. All of these factors combined results into the formation of humus, an organic layer that degrades at a very slow rate.
Rhizosphere is an active region of root growth and death. It is characterized by microbial and fungal activity. The decomposition in this zone is more rapid than in the bulk soil due to the carbon-rich exudates used by the plant roots to supplement the decomposition process of low-carbon quality organic matter. Nutrients immobilized in bacterial biomass are then released to the soil as microbivores or protozoa and nematodes that feed on the bacteria. Moreover, these microbivores remobilize the essential nutrients for plant uptake. Unlike the significant difference in the carbon to nitrogen ratio between bacteria and plant litter they feed on, there is relatively small difference in carbon to nitrogen ratio between predators and bacterial prey. Because of their relatively low assimilation efficiency, only 10 to 40% and 50 to 70% of prey carbon will be used for biomass production of protozoa and nematodes respectively. The remainder is lost as carbon dioxide in cellular respiration and the excess nitrogen is excreted as ammonia, which will be available for uptake by the plant roots within the rhizosphere. The rate of nutrient cycling in the rhizosphere are determined by the interaction between microbial decomposers and microbivores. Moreover, it strongly enhances the availability of mineral nutrients to plants. This process of supplementing carbon to microbial decomposers in the rhizosphere, enhancing the decomposition of soil organic matter, and subsequently releasing mineral nutrients for plant uptake by microbial grazers is referred to as the soil microbial loop. At the global scale, rhizosphere processes utilize approximately 50% of the energy fixed by photosynthesis in terrestrial ecosystems. Also, it contributes roughly 50% of the total carbon dioxide emitted from terrestrial ecosystems and mediates virtually all aspects of nutrient cycling. Decomposition is also observed in aquatic environments. It varies as a function of water depth and flow rate. Just like in terrestrial ecosystems, decomposition in aquatic environment involves leaching, fragmentation, colonization, and consumption by detritivores, or organism that feeds on dead and decomposing organic matter, and microbivores or organisms that feed on bacteria. In coastal environments, permanently submerged plant litters decompose more rapidly than those on the marsh surface. This is because they are more accessible to detritivores and the stable physical environment is more favorable to microbial decomposers than the alternative periods of wetting and drying that characterize tidal environments. In flowing water ecosystems, aquatic fungi colonize leaves, twigs, and other particulate matter. Meanwhile, shredders are aquatic arthropods which fragment the organic particles and eat bacteria and fungi on the litter surface. Moreover, filtering and gathering collectors are present downstream. They filter from the water fine particles and fecal material left by the shredders. Also, there are grazers and scrapers that feed on algae, bacteria, fungi, and organic matter. And these algae take up the nutrients and dissolve organic matter or DOM from the water. In still, open waters, dead organisms and other organic material called particulate organic matter, or POM, drift toward the bottom in the form of humic compounds. In shallow water, it may arrive in relatively large packages and further fragmented and digested by bottom-dwelling detritivores like crabs and snails. Meanwhile, there are bacteria living on the surface which can carry on aerobic respiration. There are also bacteria that work on the bottom or benthic organic matter. Some of them are capable of anaerobic respiration and can therefore take over decomposition. This aerobic and anaerobic decomposition in the benthic environment form only a part of the decomposition process. The dissolved organic matter, or DOM, in the water column also provides a source of fixed carbon for decomposition. The major sources of DOM are the free-floating macroalgae, phytoplankton, and zooplankton inhabiting the open water. An important component of the aquatic nutrient cycling is the microbial loop. The microbial loop is the trophic pathway through which dissolved organic matter is reintroduced to the food web by being incorporated into bacteria, which in turn are consumed by ciliates and zooplankton. The rate at which nutrients cycle through the ecosystem is directly related to the rates of primary productivity and decomposition, nutrient uptake and nutrient release respectively. The environmental factors that influence these processes will affect the rate at which nutrients cycle through the ecosystem. This is illustrated by these figures, where feedback occurs between nutrient availability, net primary productivity, and nutrient release in decomposition for initial conditions of low and high nutrient availability. The reduced nutrient availability can have the combined effect of reducing both the nutrient concentration of plant tissues or primarily leaf tissues and net primary productivity or NPP. This reduction lowers the total amount of nutrients returned to the soil in the dead organic matter. The reduced quantity and quality or nutrient concentration of organic matter entering the decomposer food chain increase immobilization and reduce the availability of nutrients for uptake by plants. In effect, low nutrient availability begets low nutrient availability. Conversely, high nutrient availability encourages high plant tissue concentrations and high NPP. In turn, the associated high quantity and quality of dead organic matter encourage the high rates of net mineralization and nutrient supply in the soil.
The vertical zones of the terrestrial ecosystem and the aquatic ecosystem differ. In terrestrial ecosystems, plants directly bridge the primary production zone and the decomposition zone. The roots gather up the nutrients from the decomposition, and the vascular system of the plants transport these nutrients throughout the plant body. However, in open water ecosystems, there is a physical separation between these zones that limits nutrient availability in the surface water. The shallow part of the aquatic ecosystem, it is similar with the terrestrial ecosystem, wherein plants directly bridge the primary production zone and the decomposition zone. In these areas, the plants are embedded in the sediments. However, as we go deeper through the aquatic ecosystem, it separates into three layers: the epilimnion, thermocline, and hypolimnion. The epilimnion or surface water is relatively warm because of the interception of solar radiation. In addition, oxygen content is also relatively high due to the diffusion of oxygen from the atmosphere into the surface waters. In contrast, the hypolimnion or deep water is cold and relatively low in oxygen. The transition zone between the surface and deep waters is characterized by a steep temperature gradient called the thermocline. Hence, the surface water is less dense and is warm, whereas the bottom layer is denser and is cold. The thermocline functions to limit the movement of nutrients from the bottom zone to the surface waters. The continuous directional movement of water affects nutrient cycling in stream ecosystems because nutrients are continuously being transported downstream. A spiral rather than a cycle better represents the cycling of nutrients. One cycle in the spiral is the uptake of an atom of nutrient, its passage through the food chain, and its return to water, where it is available for use. The cycle length involved is related to the flow rate of the stream and to the physical and biological mechanisms available for nutrient retention. Water from most streams and rivers eventually drains into the oceans, giving rise to estuary and salt marsh ecosystems along the coastal environment. As in streams and rivers, the directional flow of water functions to transport both organic matter and nutrients into and out of the ecosystem. The rise and fall of water depth with the tidal cycle serves to flush out salts and other toxins from the marshes and brings in nutrients from the coastal waters. The combined effect of the inward movement of salt water and the outward flow of fresh water develops a countercurrent that carries both living and dead particles and the nutrients they contain back towards the coastline. This mechanism conserves nutrients within the estuary and salt marsh ecosystems. The global pattern of surface currents brings about the transport of deep nutrient-rich waters to the surface in the coastal regions. As surface currents move waters away from the western coastal margins, deep water moves to the surface, carrying nutrients with it. A similar pattern of upwelling occurs in the equatorial regions of the oceans, where surface currents move to the north and south.